mean, Jowett's not back either.
No.
Okay. Just want to be sure.
Steve, could you close that door?
Steve, don't close the door.
I could.
Gina, get a jacket. Oh, me.
Iron, Gina, iron.
Down jacket, down little vest. Little natty. Okay. Neon glow.
I'll suffer.
Nobody has to suffer.
Sounded great, though.
We'll crawl over there.
Don't get you
electric
sock.
One of these were found right over here.
Is that right?
It won't be there for long, I think.
It's a coincidence.
Right over here. Just sitting there by itself.
It's found its function.
Here? Here? Yes.
I'm a food.
Okay. Gives, for energia, it gives activity or operation, and it opposes it to exis, meaning disposition, is what they give here.
Okay.
Also, can I give you workmanship? Active force.
Good, better, better.
Mm-hmm. Opposed to dunamis, it says.
What?
In opposition to dunamis.
Yeah.
So actuality. But that's Aristotle. So
that's right, actuality.
That's Plotinus.
Is this Lucia?
No. Performance?
Energia.
Function?
What is it?
Performance or function?
Performance or function.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
What are you looking at, Bart?
Energia. I have a...
What's significant about this? I mean, why should he spend so much time on something that appears to be on the surface true? So what? Said the great scholar. You remember that great scholar?
Yes, I do.
What was his name?
So what?
Right, so what? What was his doctrine?
So what?
So what?
So what? What was he known for?
So what? No, that was a far distant relative on mother-in-law's side.
Do you have, for a chance this evening, some more of your translation? For a chance?
I worked on it again, and but I'd say not here. I'd really like to discuss it with you before I. I was working on that shuttle passage. It's really got a puzzle in it, and that's what's blocking me. I got a question about how nature is being used, and I know we've talked about it.
Wonderful. Yeah, that's the problem.
And I started at the passage at 389C and was working through it, and right in the middle of that, there are the two paragraphs about, nature and how it relates to ADOS, and how that relates to the instrument.
Because this is a natural process. That's another way of translating. Where are you, Mark?
I was at 389. I started at 389B. And then I went to, from there to, through the lawgiver, so up to 390.
Well.
Yeah, so I don't know where you want to go.
Why don't we read to that point, and you can get into what you see in the translation?
Okay.
So why don't we take it at
perhaps,
just above 387, where he comes out with his thesis, or I guess we have to understand.
From
oh! I thought you were going to tell me something. Yeah, no.
So you want to pick it up?
No. Was that the man?
No.
Would you do anything quick?
What?
Would you just call Nancy and say...
Oh, yeah, I just did.
Oh.
She called me to call her.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Good.
These things are taken care of somehow, I think.
Right. 386.
Good thing we have help, that's all I say.
Okay.
386? 386E. As in Turkey. I like to show up.
Oh, good. With a lovely pair. Premonition.
Okay, the puzzle here is, what do we get with the addition? Let me read it, right? I'm in that paragraph. Then, if neither all things belong equally, blah, blah. Picking up from the semicolon. They do not vary. Swaying one way and another in accordance with our fancy, but exist of themselves in relation to their own reality imposed by nature.
See, that was retranslated, right?
Leonard Taylor?
Yes.
It is evident that there are certain things which possess the stability of essence, and this not from us, nor in consequence of being drawn upward or downward by us through the power of imagination, but which subsist from themselves according to the essence which naturally belongs to them.
According to the essence which naturally belongs to them. The essence which naturally born. But taking Thomas Taylor, how can you discover what essence naturally belongs to a thing? Well, that's the whole issue. That's the whole issue on the drawing board. We don't use the word essence. Nature of this one. So he's creating a dialogue to try to make this distinction for us.
Could we hear that again with a
sure,
question mark?
Sure.
It is evident that there are certain things which possess a stability of essence, and this not from us, nor in consequence of being drawn upwards and downwards by us through the power of imagination, but which subsist from themselves according to the essence which naturally belongs to them.
So how do you discover the essence that naturally belongs to it? In Jala, they are independent and maintain their own essence, the relation prescribed by nature. It's more cumbersome than Thomas's system. But the same issue is here. How do you discover that that relation prescribed by nature? Or in below, but exist of themselves in relation to their own reality imposed by nature. But they're all trying to get at something, I think. I think Thomas has the best.
Imposed by nature. That indicates that they didn't have it and then it was put there.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thomas Taylor has it's
natural.
It's naturally there.
Yeah, it's always
and
there.
You have to discover it. So the next distinction is we're not just talking about things, we're also talking about actions. Mm-hmm. So actions too have a natural usia or natural way of being or essence. Mm-hmm. Right, natural way of being. So I thought if we picked it up from there and get to the point, we can also hit this as we go on. Because that's anything you want to contribute. How about some readers? What do you say about that?
I'll be her.
You'll be her?
Here, my dear.
We'll be Sock.
I'll be Sock.
Thank you. Then her, certainly they are. And things themselves, then, possess such a nature as this, and that of their actions be different. Or are not actions also a class of realities? Her?
Certainly they are.
Great.
Then actions are performed according to their own nature, not according to our opinion. For instance, we undertake to cut anything, ought we to cut it as we wish and with whatever instrument we wish? Or shall we, if we are willing to cut each thing in accordance with the nature of cutting and being cut, and with the natural instrument, succeed in cutting it and do it rightly? Whereas if we try to do it contrary to nature, we shall fail and accomplish nothing.
I think the way is as you suggest.
Then too, if we undertake to burn anything, we must burn not according to every opinion, but according to the right one.
And that is as each thing naturally burns or is burned, and with the natural instrument.
True.
And all other actions are to be performed in right manner.
Certainly.
And speaking is an action, is it not?
Yes.
Then if a man speaks as he fancies, he ought to speak. If he speaks as he fancies, he ought to speak. Will he speak rightly? Will he speak if he speaks in a way and with the instrument in which and with which it is natural for us to speak and for things to be spoken, whereas otherwise he will fail and accomplish nothing?
I think the way you suggest is the right one.
Now, naming is a part of speaking, for in naming, I suppose, people utter speech.
Certainly.
Then is not naming also a kind of action?
of this speaking is a kind of action concerned with him.
Yes. But we saw that actions are not merely relative to us, but possess a separate nature of their own.
True.
Then in naming also, if we are to be consistent with our previous conclusions, we cannot follow our own will, but the way and the instrument which the nature of things prescribes must be employed, must they not? And if we pursue this course, we shall be successful in our naming, but otherwise we shall fail.
I think you're right.
Then the argument would lead us to infer that names ought to be given according to a natural process and with a proper instrument, not at our pleasure. This, and no other way, shall we name with success.
And
that's where we're going. Go ahead.
And again, what has to be cut, he said, has to be cut with something.
Certainly.
And what has to be woven has to be woven with something. And what has to be bored has to be bored with something.
Certainly.
And then what has to be named with something.
True.
And what is that with which we have to bore?
A border.
And that with which we weave?
A shell.
And that with which we must name?
A name.
Right. A name also, then, is a kind of instrument.
Certainly.
And if I were to ask, what instrument is the shuttle? Is it not that which with which we weave?
Yes.
And what do we mean when we weave? Do we not separate and the mingled threads of warp and woof?
Yes.
And you could give a similar answer about the borer and the rest, could you not?
Certainly.
And can you say something of the same kind about a name? The name being an instrument, what do we do with it when we name?
I cannot tell.
Do we not teach one another something? We separate things according to their natures?
Certainly.
A name is, then, an instrument of teaching and of separating reality. As a shuttle is an instrument of separating the web.
Yes.
But the shuttle is an instrument of weaving?
Of course.
The weaver, then, will use the shuttle well. And well means like a weaver. And a teacher will use a name well. And well means like a teacher.
Yes.
whose work will the weaver use well when he uses the shuttle?
The carpenter's.
Is everyone a carpenter, or he who has the skill?
He who has the skill.
And whose work will the hole maker use when he uses the borer?
The smith's.
And is everyone a smith, or he who has the skill?
He who has the skill.
And whose work will the teacher use when he uses the name?
I cannot tell that either.
And can you not tell this either, who gives the names we use?
No.
Do you not think it is the law that gives them to us?
Very likely.
Then the teacher, when he uses a name, will be using the work of a lawgiver.
I think so.
Do you think every man is a lawgiver, or only he who has the skill?
He who has the skill.
Then is it not for every man, Hermogenes, to give names, but for him who may be called a name maker? Let me read that again. Then it is not for every man, Hermogenes, to give names, but for him who may be called the name maker. And he, it appears, is the lawgiver, who is of all the artisans among men the rarest.
So it appears.
See now what the lawgiver has in view in giving names. Look at it in the light of what has gone before. What has the carpenter in view when he makes the shuttle? Is it not something the nature of which is to weave?
Certainly.
Well then, if the shuttle breaks while he is making it, will he make another with his mind fixed on that which is broken, or on that form with reference to which he was making the one which he broke?
On that form, in my opinion.
Then we should very properly call that shuttle.
Yes, I think so.
Then whenever he has to make a shuttle for a light, or a thick garment, or for one of linen or of wool, or of any kind whatsoever, all of them must contain the form or ideal of shuttle. And in each of his products, he must embody the nature which is naturally best for each.
Yes.
And the same applies to all other instruments. The artisan must discover the instrument naturally fitted for each purpose, and must embody that in the material of which he makes the instrument, not in accordance with his own will, but in accordance with his nature. He must, it appears, know how to embody in the iron the bore fitted by nature for each special use.
Certainly.
And he must embody in the wood the shuttle fitted by nature for each kind of weaving.
True.
For each kind of shuttle is, it appears, fitted by nature for its particular kind of weaving, and the like is true of other instruments.
Yes.
Then, my dear friend, must not the lawgiver also know how to embody in the sounds and syllables that name which is fitted by nature for each object? Must he not make and give all his names with his eye fixed upon the name if he is to be an authoritative giver of names? I have written in the margin for each that is, but I don't know where that goes. Must he not make and give all his names with his eye fixed upon the name for each that is? That's where it goes. Are you there, Papa?
I think so, yeah.
If he is to be an authoritative giver of names. And if different lawgivers do not embody it in the same syllables, he must not forget what each is on that account. For different smiths do not embody the form in the same iron, though making the same instrument for the same purpose. But so long as they reproduce the same ideal, though it be in a different iron, still the instrument is as it should be, whether it be made here or in foreign lands, is it not?
Certainly.
On this basis, then, he will judge the lawgiver, whether he be here or in a foreign land, so long as he gives to each thing the proper form of the name, and whatsoever syllables, to be no worse lawgiver, whether here or anywhere else, will you not?
Certainly.
Now, who is likely to know whether the proper form of shuttle is embodied in any piece of wood, the carpenter who made it, or the weaver who is to use it?
Probably the one who is to use it, Socrates.
Then who is to use the wood of the lyre maker? Is not he the man who would know best how to superintend the making of the lyre, and would also know whether it is well made or not when it is finished?
Certainly.
Who is he?
The lyre player.
And who would know best about the work of the shipbuilder?
The navigator.
And who can best superintend the work of the lawgiver and judge of it when it is finished, both here and in foreign countries, the user, is it not?
Yes.
And is not this he who knows how to ask questions?
Certainly.
And the same one knows also how to make replies?
Yes.
And the man who knows how to ask and answer questions, you call a dialectician?
Yes, that is what I call him.
The work of the carpenter, then, is to make a rudder under the supervision of the steersman, if the rudder is to be a good one.
Evidently.
And the work of the lawgiver, at the same, is to make a name with the dialectician as the supervisor.
supervisor if names are to be well given.
True.
Then Hermogenes, the giving of names can hardly be as you imagine a trifling matter, or a task for trifling with casual persons. And Catullus is right in saying that names belong to things by nature, and that not everyone is an artesian of names, but only he who keeps in view the name which belongs by nature to each particular thing and is able to embody its form in the letters and symbols.
I do not know how to answer you, Socrates. Nevertheless, it is not easy to change my conviction so suddenly. I think you would be more likely to convince me if you were to show me just what it is that you say is the natural correctness of names.
I, my dear Hermogenes, do not say that there is any. You forget what I said a while ago, that I did not know, but would join you in looking for the truth. And now, as we are looking, you and I, we already see one thing we did not know before, that names do possess a certain natural correctness, and that not every man knows how to give a name well to anything whatsoever. Is that not true?
Certainly.
Then our next task is to try to find out, if you care to know about it, what kind of correctness that is which belongs to names.
To be sure, I care to know.
Then investigate.
How shall I investigate?
The best way to investigate, my friend, is with the help of those who know. And you make sure of their favor by paying them money. They are the sophist, from whom your brother Callias got his reputation for wisdom by paying them a good deal of money. But since you have not the control of your inheritance, you ought to beg and beseech your brother to teach you the correctness which he learned of Protagoras about such matters.
It would be an absurd request for me, Socrates, if I, who reject the truth of Protagoras altogether, should desire what is said in such a truth as if it were of any value.
Then if you do not like that, you ought to learn from Homer and the other poets.
Why, Socrates, what does Homer say about names and where?
In many passages, but chiefly and most admirably in those in which he distinguishes between the names by which gods and men call the same things. Do you not think he gives in those passages great and wonderful information about the correctness of names? For clearly, the gods call things by the names that are naturally right. Do you not think so?
Of course I know that if they call things, they call them rightly. But what are these instances to which you refer?
Do you not know that he says about the river in Troilen, which had the single combat with Hephaestus, whom the gods call Xanthus, but men call Scamander?
Oh, yes.
Well, do you not think this is a grand thing to know? That the name of that river is rightly Xanthus rather than Scamander? Or if you like, do you think it is a slight thing to learn about the bird which he calls, gods call Calchas, but men call Semindus, that it is much more correct for the same bird to be called Chalcis than Semindus, or to learn that the hill men call Parva, what's that word?
Bathia.
Bathia is called by the men's Marina's tomb, and many other such statements by Homer and other poets. But perhaps these matters are too high for us to understand. It is, I think, more within human power to investigate the names Scamandrius and to annex and understand what kind of correctness he ascribes to these, which he says are the names of Hector's son. You recall, of course, the lines which contain the words to which I refer?
Certainly.
Which of the names of the boy do you imagine Homer thought was more correct? Astyanax or Scamandrius?
I cannot say.
Look at it in this way. Suppose you were asked, do the wise or the unwise give names more correctly?
The wise, obviously, I should say.
And do you think the women or the men of the city, regarded as a class in general, are the wiser?
The men.
And do you not know that Homer says the child of Hector was called Astyanax by the men of Troy? So he must have been called Scamandrius by the women, since the men called him Astyanax.
Yes, probably.
And Homer, too, thought the Trojan men were wiser than the women?
I suppose he did.
Then he thought Astyanax was more rightly the boy's name than Scamandrius.
So it appears.
Let us, then, consider the reason for this. Does he not himself indicate the reason most admirably? For he says, he alone defended their city and long walls. Therefore, as it seems, it is right to call the son of the defender Astyanax, lord of the city, ruler of that which his father, as Homer says, defended.
Well, that is clear to me.
Indeed, I do not yet understand about it myself, Hermogenes, do you?
No, by Zeus, I do not.
Oh, my good friend.
Stop cursing.
Did not Homer himself also give Hector his name?
Why do you ask that?
Because that name seems to me similar to Astyanax, and both names seem to be Greek. For Lord and Holder mean nearly the same thing, indicating that they are names of a king. For surely a man is holder of that of which he is lord. For it is clear that he rules it and possesses it and holds it. But does it seem to you that there is nothing in what I am saying? Am I wrong in imagining that I have found a clue to Homer's opinion about the correctness of names?
No, by Zeus, you are not wrong in my opinion. I think perhaps you have found a clue.
It is right, I think, to call a lion's offspring a lion and a horse's offspring a horse. I am not speaking of prodigies, such as the birth of some other kind of creature from a horse, but of the natural offspring of each species after its kind. If a horse, contrary to nature, should bring forth a calf, the natural offspring of a cow, it should be called a calf, not a colt. Nor if any offspring that is not human should be born from a human being, should that other offspring be called a human being? And the same applies to trees and all the rest. Do you not agree?
Yes.
Good, but keep watch of me. And do not let me trick you. For by the same argument, any offspring of a king should be called a king. And whether the same meaning is expressed in one set of syllables or another makes no difference. And if a letter is added or subtracted, that does not matter either, so long as the essence of the thing named remains in force and is made plain in the name.
What do you mean?
Something quite simple. For instance, when we speak of the letters of the alphabet, you know, we speak their names, not merely the letters themselves, except in the case of four. Somebody else is going to have to.
Epsilon, Upsilon, Omicron, Omega.
Thank you. We make names for all the other words and consonants by adding other letters to them. And so long as we include the letter in question and make its force plain, we may properly call it by that name, and that will designate it for us. Take beta, for instance. The addition of
epsilon, beta, tau, and alpha
does no harm and does not prevent the whole name from making clear the nature of that letter which the lawgiver wished to designate. He knew so well how to give letters, excuse me, he knew so well how to give names to letters.
I think you're right.
Does not the same reasoning apply to a king? A king's son will probably be a king. A good man's good, a handsome man's handsome, and so forth. The offspring of each class will be of the same class, unless some unnatural birth takes place. So they should be called by the same names. But variety in the syllables is admissible, so that names which are the same appear different to the uninitiated, just as the physician's drug, when prepared with various colors and perfumes, seems different to us, though they are the same, but to the physician who considers only their medicinal value, they seem the same, and he is not confused by the additions. So perhaps the man who knows about names considers their value and is not confused if some letter is added, transposed, or subtracted, or even if the force of the name is expressed in entirely different letters. So, for instance, in the names we were just discussing, Astyanax and Hector, none of the letters is the same except T. But nevertheless, they have the same meaning. And what letters has Archipolos, ruler of the city, in common with them? Yet it means the same thing. And there are many other names which mean simply king. Others again mean general, such as Aegis, leader, Polemarchus, warlord, and Eupolemus, good warrior. And others indicate physicians as
Eutrochlus,
thank you, famous physician, and
Acus and Brodus,
healer of mortals. And we might perhaps find many others which differ in syllables and letters that express the same meaning. Do you think that is true or not?
So agree.
To those then who are born in accordance with nature, the same name should be given.
Yes.
But how about those who are born contrary to nature as prodigies? For instance, when an impious son is born to a good man, to a good and pious man, ought he not, as in our former example, when a mare brought forth a calf, to have the designation of the class to which he belongs instead of that of his parent?
Certainly.
Then the impious son of a pious father ought to receive the name of his class.
Sure.
Not Theopatus, beloved of God. Thank you, David. Mindful of God. Or anything of that sort. But something of opposite meaning if names are correct.
Most assuredly, Socrates.
As the name Orestes, mountain man, and is undoubtedly correct, Hermogenes, whether it was given him by chance or by some poet who indicated by the name the fierceness, rudeness, and mountain wildness of his nature.
So it seems, Socrates.
And his father's name also appears to be in accordance with nature.
It seems so.
Yes, for Agamemnon, admirable for remaining, is one who would resolve to toil to the end and to endure, putting the finish upon his resolution by virtue. And a proof of this is his long retention of the host at Troy and his endurance. So the name Agamemnon denotes that this man is admirable for remaining. And so, too, the name Atreus is likely to be correct, for his murder of Chrysippus and the cruelty of his acts to Theseus.
Thyestes?
You could put that in.
Okay. And the cruelty of his acts to Thyestes are all damaging and ruinous to his virtue. Now the form of his name is slightly deflected and hidden, so that it does not make the man's nature plain to everyone. But to makes the meaning of Atreus plain enough, for indeed, in view of his stubbornness and fearlessness and ruinous acts, the name is correctly given to him on every ground. And I think Pelops also has a fitting name, for this name means that he who sees only what is near deserves this designation.
How is that?
Why, it is said of him that in murdering Romulus, he was quite unable to forecast or perceive the ultimate effects upon his whole race, and all the misery with which it was overwhelmed, because he saw only the near at hand and the immediate. That is to say, near. Pelops? In his eagerness to win by all means the hand of Hippodamia. And anyone would think the name Tantalus was given rightly and in accordance with nature if the stories about him are true.
What are the stories?
The many tales.
So, Barbara, where do you want to direct us?
I was mentioned to you that I had a puzzle at 389C, and that's true. C and D. Mm-hmm. Well, there's two possibilities. I guess there is two possibilities. I can show you what I did with it and why I have a question, or I can just tell you why I have a question. Which would you like?
Well, when offered two, take one. Take them both.
Okay. So the paragraph that the first problem that I had was in the paragraph at 389C. And it isn't, and if anybody, David or Sarah, can throw light on this, if I'm just misreading some grammatical part or from any aspect, jump in, don't hesitate. I'll only be embarrassed, humiliated, ridiculed.
No, I can't wait.
Don't let that bother you.
I can't wait.
Okay, so I translated it like this. The paragraph that starts, whenever he has to make a shuttle, and I read it this way.
Yes.
389C. Then whenever he has to make, just above it, just above C. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. So whenever it's necessary that he make a shuttle for a light or a heavy cloak, for linen or for wool or for any sort whatever, for all these, he necessarily holds the eidos of shuttle to give from it this nature into each work. Then for each, the best shuttle has naturally arisen. Is the way I translated that. Yeah. So whenever it's necessary that he make a shuttle for a light or a heavy cloak, for linen or for wool or for any sort whatever, for all these he necessarily holds the eidos of shuttle to give from it this nature into each work.
To give?
From it.
give from it.
It's to give.
That's right.
Okay.
To give from it.
This.
What? This.
Nature.
Mm-hmm.
Into each work. Or working out. It's a word that could go that way. Then, for each, the best shuttle has an. Okay. Now, what I did with it, or what the problem I have with it, is that they have two expressions. It's necessary to give from apadunai, comes from apadidomai, and indicates a direction, which is why I translated it the way I did, to give. Because he repeats that same form, same with the same preposition. He doesn't use the straight giving word. Okay, and but there's no from it literally, in that there's no object in the text. Okay? But okay, so it's necessary to give, and then the next phrase in parallel construction is to put into the iron. Okay. And those are parallel grammatical constructions, but it appears to me, so it's like, so you'd have, it's necessary to give, I'm in the wrong paragraph, excuse me, in the wrong Greek paragraph. So where am I?
Just go back to Holes there, also.
Yeah. Yeah, the same form. It's necessary to hold the eidos and to give this nature into each work. They're both infinitives. And so it appears to me that they go together in that sense. But there's a mende construction that is, it's necessary to hold the eidos on the one hand, so that the best nature naturally arises, comes to be, on the other hand. Right? That those two things are set off in a different kind of construction.
Okay. Then for each, right?
Mm-hmm.
How do you translate
that? Mm-hmm.
Then for each, the...
The best shuttle has naturally arisen. So the question I had is, you're holding the eidos and you're giving this nature into each, it could be into each shuttle that you actually make, into each, okay? So does that mean that the nature is the eidos in the work? I guess I got questions about what constitutes the nature at that point. Okay. And also, it just sounds very strange to say that the shuttle then will naturally come about. You know, it's interesting to me, like as an idea, but it suggests the artisan's kind of a. And as he does later, stands out of the way, and he holds on to the eidos, and then he has to know how to put it into the metal, but he doesn't add to it. His is a discipline.
Yeah.
So that's interesting to me.
Yeah, well, it certainly seems true, doesn't it? Or where's your confusion?
It's not really, that part isn't really a confusion. Mm-hmm. I like that part.
He said, okay, it's the next one that's the computer.
Yeah. Well, So does it seem fair to say that that's, therefore, that's, that I, the explanation that I gave of eidos is fair? I mean, how eidos and nature, and, or should we go on and look at the other paragraph? Because they each put those terms in a certain, in certain relationships. The next paragraph as well. The eidos, the, there's also the how the instrument relates to,
Well, let me ask you a question.
Mm-hmm.
Could anyone just make a show?
Could anyone? No, I wouldn't think so.
Could someone who's trained as a carpenter make a show?
Not unless he knew something more.
Well, what would he have to know more?
He'd have to know weaving.
Or he had to be told from about a
by a weaver?
By a weaver.
Mm-hmm. He'd have to have some grasp of it, yeah.
All right. Then, could he then make the shuttle?
If he... Okay. If he held, the conditions hear us, he has to hold on to that while he's making it.
Can he make a shuttle?
Can he make a shuttle?
I'm playing on the word. Wouldn't you agree, no carpenter can make a chair?
Ah,
yeah.
He makes a
copy.
Of the
better than that. Would you agree he can't even make a copy?
Of a chair? Not yet, I wouldn't.
Okay.
How
he,
so?
He has to make a particular chair.
Yeah, oh. He does. Right.
He never makes a chair.
No. He renders a copy of a chair.
A particular kind of chair. You can't make a shuttle.
Mm-hmm.
You have to make what?
A particular shuttle for a particular purpose.
A particular kind of purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Particular weave and size
mm-hmm.
of thread.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, you can't make a shuttle.
Right.
Okay. Then he holds the idea of the shuttle
mm-hmm.
right, to give from it, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's very nice the way you did it.
Mm-hmm.
To give from it this nature of the shuttle
mm-hmm.
into each of the particular works
mm-hmm. that he makes.
Or each of its adaptations.
Versions
forms.
Was a word I thought about possible.
Yeah.
Uh-huh, or is it something?
Then for each that's done that way,
mm-hmm.
it's the best shuttle that has naturally arisen.
Mm-hmm.
Right? If it's gone through that process, then for each it's the best that could be made, and naturally.
Mm-hmm.
But the idea of the shuttle doesn't improve, only the each. So the idea of man would have within it everything that there is. There's no way to improve upon the idea. Because the improvement's already built into the idea.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because how can you understand anything? How can you understand anything? Unless whatever a thing is, it discloses in some way its own nature.
I can see how you can do that without looking at function.
And that's function.
Yeah,
no, proper function.
Yeah, how do you see essence? I don't know.
Well, you don't have to worry about seeing essence. If you can see its proper function, then
mm-hmm.
you can ask how function is related to essence.
Yeah, but Jeff, that's what you see first, right? Yeah. Function?
But to see function means you grasp the idea.
Oh, I see. Okay.
So, like, in this paragraph that we stopped,
mm-hmm.
saying,
mm-hmm.
right? Then the idea that each thing has its proper work or proper function peculiar to it. If each thing has a proper function peculiar to it, then it has its own unique quality. That's who sees it.
Mm-hmm.
That's its unique possession.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Which is why they can use the word usia for wealth. It's your unique possession. It's, from, mm-hmm. it's your wealth in one way. That's your wealth. Right? It has to show itself. That's right. It shows itself in its proper function. It's not when it's doing anything else. Right, man can do a whole range of things, can't he?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking of.
Right, all kinds of things he can do. Well, you won't be able to understand the intelligibility of man until you understand what is his proper function.
Yeah.
When is he most a man? When is particular uniqueness, right, which lies at the core of his being, exhibit itself, that's when he fulfills his proper function.
Okay, so you're speaking of specific, like a specific shuttle or a specific man, not mankind or the idea of shuttle. Is that what you're saying?
Well, perhaps. Suppose, though, see, it's now what's going to be the shuttle. And the particular shuttle, that's where you're going. You're saying, do individual men stand to one another as individual forms of shuttles? Then each particular form of the shuttle has a unique and particular function, just like each particular man had a particular function.
Mm-hmm.
But the particular function that he's assigning to the highest function of man is the dialectician. Isn't
it? Then I ask the right question, because he gives the lawgiver the information.
Then he gives the lawgiver. He's a step behind the shuttle. He's two steps behind the shuttle. See? It's, we have to build the image.
Before.
Right. Well, there's the idea of the shuttle, and there's the carpenter.
Mm-hmm.
Behind the carpenter must be the weaver, the person who's going to use it.
Mm-hmm.
So when you get to man, what he's going to do, he can do a wide range of things. We want to know what is unique to him, so that when he exhibits it, he's exhibiting the most profound part of his nature. That's what we want to do. So
I was an ask and answer question.
Yeah. Pardon?
When you said to ask and answer?
To ask and answer questions.
The use of the name.
What?
The use of the name, I was just thinking.
Yeah,
the use of the language.
Yeah. Like, this is a way. Rather than describing men, this is a model for describing how you can discover the intelligibility that exists, rather than a model for each man. But there's a class of things called instruments, and there's a proper function for each. And if you can understand the proper function for each, then you won't use it in the wrong way, and that becomes the intelligibility of the thing. It's a way of understanding. If you see the way in which people use names, then you can discover that there are only certain words they're using correctly. And you'll see that they're correct because they're functioning properly. Right? Like, who is your mother? Try that. Who is your mother?
Who's my mother?
Who is your mother?
I don't know what you're asking for. Are you asking for a name?
Yeah.
Grace.
Mm-hmm. Say, who functions like your mother? Who or what functions like your mother? What does that do?
Who?
Gives me a longer list.
Yeah.
Let me go the next step, all right? Say, I made a mistake. I shouldn't have asked you who your mother was or how she functions. I need a better name. Okay? Therefore, a better answer. Who is functioning the way a mother should ideally function? Now what do we have?
Short list,
right? What do we do?
We have to see what is that proper function.
Right.
You have to identify that before you can measure.
Let's try it then. If there is such a thing as being a mother, right? And if we can say ideally, what is the pure eidos of mother? Like, what is that?
Nurture.
Nourish.
Nourishing.
Protect.
Instruct.
Pardon?
Instruct.
Or guide.
Instruct. Comfortable. Guide. Right. What are we building? We're building an eidos of mother, aren't we?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Right. Okay. Then you can ask, can you not, what are who functions like a mother? Ideally. Or isn't that really who's your mother? Mm-hmm. I mean, if names are given properly, right? Someone says, "Well, I know who my mother is, Frances." Say, "No kidding." Well, what's she like? Oh, she's like a black widow spider, as a matter of fact. Functions exactly in the same way. You say, "Wait, shit! Don't give me the wrong name. I didn't ask you who was a, you know." Whether there's someone who acts like a black widow spider. Like, what would happen if everybody just decided just for one day, no more names on anything that it doesn't fit? Just by this one rule, what the hell would happen? You get a phone call and someone says, "Hey, the son of a bitch is on the phone."
Call him the way you see him, then.
Right? You don't want to speak to this son of a bitch, do you?
The bitch is on the phone.
Right? Or, hey, the school's on the phone. What do you mean, the school's on the phone? You haven't educated anybody in years.
The babysitter's on the phone.
Yeah, babysitter's on the phone.
Words can't describe.
Right, the parasite's on the phone. Mm-hmm. Oh, IRS, huh? Right? Like, what would happen if you just decided? Just go through just one day, just name. Right, Michael? What would happen to his life if children would change? Let's not bring Michael into it. Right, Mike? Look here. That's what he's trying to do. He's trying to say, "Look, yeah, come on now, let's name things by their function." And look what would happen. Okay, just where we ended. That kind of fun thing you did with the names of the poets at 395 C, just above C. Now the form of his name is slightly deflected and hidden, so that it does not make the man's nature plain to everyone. See, if names reflected the nature, then it would be plain to everyone what we're doing, wouldn't it?
Mm-hmm.
All right. But to those who understand about names, it makes the meaning of Atreus plain enough when he goes to a point to try to make that clear. And the point is, he can either be playing or not. It doesn't make any difference, you know. I mean, the etymology is either can be sound or it can't be. That's the point he's making. And he can be having a lot of fun with etymologies. They can be all off the wall or anything else, but they can be real. Because that's the point he wants to make. Hey, if you understand. If you understand functions, then you should be able to then try to capture that in the word. You know, and of course he gets that great one, the only similarity is the letter T. You know.
Yeah.
And it's still okay.
Still okay.
And after you take all those letters away.
So look here. So you have to hold in your mind, all right, let's go back to mother. You have to hold in your mind what that really is, don't you? Say, who's your mother? Hold in mind exactly what that should be, right? And then what? Then, right? Then what? Then you give from it to something. Don't you? You give from it what you've discovered in the Eidos, in the idea of what a mother is that right?
Mm-hmm.
And you give from it this nature, this thing that you've discovered behind what the image of mother is. Right? Into each activity, every work. Right? Then for each of its functions or work, right? That would be the best that naturally arises through. All right, look at the ones we had a moment ago. Nurture, did we not? Nurture. Nurture, education, did we not? Care, guide, love, all right? Got all of those. Now, for each of those, they have to be clear in your mind, don't they? Mm-hmm. What's really to educate, right? So you're doing nothing but pure terms, aren't you?
Mm-hmm.
Right, you got all pure terms. Right. Now, what is functioning in those ways around you?
Hmm.
Right. So you draw in that pure sense. So that.
And you would recognize an account.
Yeah.
Right. Or be able to make a model or give an account yourself. Would you not? Because you could. Put it in words that were appropriate to its
because
nature.
Because presupposes that you're first able to see. You can't do it unless you see the idea.
Mm-hmm.
You agree? You can't do this
right.
Unless you can see the idea.
Right.
You have to have an idealized form of all of this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Hero. Okay, what's a hero?
Now, what is a hero?
Right? Poets. What's a hero? I mean, you have to have that clear in your mind first. All right, what are the things around it? They have to be clear. What functions that way? When? Under what circumstances? So he sharpens, isn't he? Right, let's pull it out. Like, what's behind the shelf? The carpenter, the carpet behind the cupboard. The carpenter is a weaver. Right. In front of the shuttle is the particular variations of which shuttles must take. Depending upon how they function. And the final result then would be a good woven garment or cloth, wouldn't
mm-hmm.
it? That could then be an excellent garment.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole thing is to produce something that's good. Naturally fitted to do the thing, all the way back, everything is working ideally. Is it not?
Indeed.
Yeah. Well then what are you getting from this? What are you getting from this? You're looking at something and say, hey, you know what? This rug, man, it's ideal. Guy who can say that, right? What does he know? He knows his whole structure, all the way back. Right, the instruments I've weaved. What circumstances they were improved, right? A man who really knows rugs could tell you whether or not, what?
I mean, any model or idea.
Whether it was made right, with the tools that were used to make it, with the proper tools to use it. He could spot the flaws in it pretty much, just like that. An artisan who knows his work, right?
Mm-hmm.
So then that makes this intelligible. Doesn't it? It makes us intelligent. Then we can understand it. We can understand things, can't we? With such a model? Well, okay. That's interesting. So now the rug's intelligent. So what? Now, is he using this whole structure for some purpose? Well, everything he uses here then has to turn upon, right? It's an analogy, and next to it is words. Isn't that what he's constantly doing?
Yes. Taking the fabric of reality and weaving it, isn't he?
Sure, that's right.
So the shuttle is the name?
Yeah,
sure. It's also a function, name. They used it twice.
Yeah.
It is the thing as well as the action.
Because it does something.
Yeah, to name, so that name and to name. It's a noun, noun, and a verb, right?
Yeah. But the name does two things, too. Right? It teaches, and it separates the usia, right? It distinguishes reality.
What's interesting is it both separates it, and it functions as the unifier, that, right? Which I found fascinating, that it would do that.
Well, it would unify by putting all of those things in the same class? Is that what you mean by unify?
I just meant in the image of a shuttle, when he compares the shuttle to the function of speech and naming in speech, the teacher, that in the same way that the shuttle separates the threads of the weaving, it also does not pull the thread behind it that ultimately creates the fabric. So it was just fascinating to me that function would then have to be the same, that he makes distinctions, but the ultimate function of the distinctions that he makes is to create a oneness.
Hold it all together.
A whole,
hold it all together.
And at each point he finishes it, in that sense.
Yeah, with each path, or, yeah, that's right.
Okay, the artisan must discover the instrument naturally fitted for each purpose and must embody that in the material of which he makes the instrument. Let me go back just to have some fun. Wouldn't you agree about this structure?
This is the eidos, or the idea. Call it eidos, the idea. Let's use the example we used before. The idea of what it is to be that. Right. And now we have this name for particular Helen.
Right.
And because Helen is this, because we say Helen is this, and we know how Helen functions, we say, that's what it is to be a mother. Now, Helen could be a spider lady. Right?
Black widow spider. Mm-hmm. Or, what? Give me another image. Let us say she functions like
a great cat.
A priest. Catholic priest.
Mm-hmm.
Catholic priest, especially at confession. Right? That's her major. That's Helen. That's really what she does. So, We should, what should we call it? Father Violet.
Father Helen.
But she's not functioning like a mother.
Yeah, but that's what she is, that's the way she's functioning.
That's how she's functioning, but that's not the ideal mother.
Yeah, we're totally in agreement. Okay, now, this is the person, daughter and son. When you raise this and say, look, you've got to put the proper name on what's going on, the difficulty is that the person wants to save this image of them.
Sure, all right.
Like, that's the nature of the problem. They want to keep the egos. They want to say, that's really what they were all the time.
They protect and nourish.
And they don't want to see the function. So that this becomes all kinds of, if I wasn't such a sinner, Helen wouldn't have to function as a priest. Becomes this person's statement.
Yeah, that's the chicken or the egg thing, though.
Yeah. So, the defense was, how could you possibly say that about your
mother?
That's the ideal. So mm-hmm. That's the ideal. Mm-hmm. So, if we only talked about how things function, what would happen to this problem? Wouldn't there? Or you might have to go around and say, what is the proper role for a priest? Wouldn't it? Mm-hmm. Like, these would then have to be clarified.
Well,
and rendered more intelligible. To the degree that this becomes more intelligible, what happens then to these? To the distinctions you draw?
They're much easier.
They're much more clear to see what they will.
Yeah. Well, then you're balancing idea and function. But the drama is when someone brings up, this is brought to life. He went, oh no. He said, oh no. The back neighbor. Now, let's have some fun. Yeah, go ahead, David.
I was wondering what would happen to a craftsman if he did what most people do to names in his craft with his ideals. He wouldn't stay in business very long. But we allow ourselves to do it with names.
Yeah. Now, here's where Plato is at. Mm-hmm. Okay, now, what is man? What is it? All right? Hey, here's man in the form of woman, right? Okay. Go ahead and finish it. Here's a Helen, or a Joe, or whatever. Well, then how should he function?
Ruler.
What is that function which manifests the nature of man?
Right. What is the nature of man such that, he has a nature. Yeah. Right? And that's grasped in some way by the Eidos. Mm-hmm. And that's the unique quality of what it is to be a man. That's its usia. That's its unique possession, as it were. Right? Well, he's saying, you know what? You can see that in terms of this. A whole range of ways in which we can function, but that has to be in terms of this.
Because mm-hmm. many of our functions may be no different from other animals, for
That's
example.
Right.
Sure. You're talking about reflecting, you know, what are you saying?
Like, what can you bring to what it is you do that makes you a man?
Can reflect.
In everything that you do. Because obviously, if it's only one or two activities, then it's only when you're in those one or two activities that you're in
now. Reason.
When you're reflecting on the level of eidos, are you in the realm of Lucia at that point? You know, are you in...
I think you're in the realm of the logos.
The logos. Oh. Because Lucia is something that you manifest? Or... just puzzled me, the relationship. I kind of just kept wondering how to resolve it.
Well, you said there's a whole range of living creatures.
Yeah.
Right. One of them in here is man.
I. Mm-hmm.
There is a uniqueness, is there not?
Yes.
Right, that's the assumption of all
that's
of this.
That's the assumption.
Of all of this thought.
Mm-hmm.
Right. It's not an accidental quality or a particular quality, like the particular length of someone's ear.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That's not what we mean by uniqueness
mm-hmm.
in this sense.
Mm-hmm.
It's a general uniqueness.
Not a physical anthropology characteristic.
Right. Okay. It's
so then that's a unique quality. All right. It's a unique quality. Or possession. I think it takes on the form of possession. Right. There's a unique quality or possession of man. What it is that a man is that makes a man, different from all the others. And this, right, when it is in something, but. It can be represented in an idea, can it not?
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
that's what they're saying. There's an eidos of it. Uh-huh.
Right? That's the eidos.
Mm-hmm.
That's the eidos.
Mm-hmm. It can be grasped and held.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay. Now, this has a particular way of being, without using that word.
Mm-hmm.
Right? This... because of its uniqueness, it does something in respect to that particular uniqueness that is so rich to mark the particular thing as different from all of the other different species. And therefore we can expect it to be exhibited. Right? It's exhibited.
You have a unique function?
And that's its function. That's its function. That's its function. Right. Now, of course, this guy can function in a variety of ways.
Yeah.
And we're saying, wait a minute, right. Pick out that particular way of being which really represents this.
Mm-hmm.
Then it will be this.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to, right. That's this.
Mm-hmm.
All right, then it won't, though you can do many things, you can live in various ways, these which represent the unique qualities that make the particular uniqueness right, of man, that's its function.
And that function may allow
that's its specific
things.
Purpose, if you want. That's natural to it. That's where it gets the idea of natural. Not nature out there in the
uh-huh.
woods. Right? There's a natural affinity between this and this and this. Isn't it? Right? This should be its
natural
function. It naturally follows from this, which can be represented in
right.
this.
Right. Okay.
And therefore, these three together are it's intelligible. That's what it is to be intelligible. To grasp that's knowing its intelligible whatness. Right? That's how it's intelligible. Then. But that's what a man knows. And that's what he knows. He can express an idea that particular quality of possession exhibits in a particular natural function which is in line with that.
Hmm.
Right?
Yeah. If that's what I'm... Yeah. Does that make... a man by nature and dialectician?
Yeah. Pretty sad. Because you have to be a dialectician once you see this. Once you see this, you have to be a dialectician. You have no choice.
You oversee the maker of names.
Yeah. Right? You could go to someone and say, okay, well, now let's talk about what you think this idea is. What's your grip on this idea? Then we talk about that particular quality of that thing, and then it's going to function naturally in respect to that. Okay, now let's name things properly. Right? You're naturally going to be a dialectician. Right? What do we always do in midwifery? Right? Tell me how it functions. People have masks. Forget the mask. How do they function, Dan? Right? Don't tell me they look sweet. Right? Or this or that. Mm-hmm. How do they function? Right? Because then you can see they're not being what they should be. That's the idea.
And that's the confusion.
And that's the confusion. That's the only confusion. We want to preserve the egos. Mm-hmm. And the people don't function as egos because mm-hmm. they don't have, perhaps they don't have to function properly anymore. Mm-hmm. We have a situation where we have a neighbor who's a animal trainer. And instead of using a whip, they use harsh words for animal training.
Are these the people with the other small child, similar?
Yeah, in the neighborhood, yeah. Animal trainers. And heard the greatest line today I've heard in a long time. Little guy is 8 months old. And he's with his mother. And mother's talking to a couple of people. So, and the kid goes, mother turns around and says, "If you don't shut up, I'm gonna take care of you. Now I told you I'm gonna get you at home." 8 months old. Does the kid understand of all of this?
He will soon.
Right, but he got the message. I mean, somehow, yeah. You know, that voice.
Yeah.
Right? That voice got to be good. 8 months on. Kids already trained. Animal trained.
Snarl.
Well, it's okay. Teeth. Yeah, you don't need words. You could have snarled.
Mm-hmm.
Couldn't. You could
mm-hmm.
snarl.
Yeah. Right? Yeah, you know when a dog does that, what he's talking about.
Yeah,
you know,
a dog's talking about. Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, it's a crazy kind of animal. Maybe you'd say, no, that's not even an animal trainer. He wouldn't get far being an animal trainer. Oh, okay, no, that's out.
And what is it? An animal to another animal.
Yeah, an animal to another animal.
Yeah. One animal to another. So, therefore, brutes.
Right. Barbarian.
Or it's a man-child being born to an animal. If they're talking about,
yeah. Or a prodigy.
You call the mother a prodigy, yeah.
A child prodigy.
You call the mother wolf, and you call the kid when it becomes.
Yeah, that's right.
As it becomes.
On the process of becoming another wolf.
Oh, in the process of becoming another wolf. So what is he doing? He's saying, hey, give the names according to the way it's functioning, and you'll call that person a wolf. You'll say they're raising a wolf. Forget about how it looks and whether it cuts its hair around. Wow, that's a relief, isn't it? Oh, now it's intelligible. Now you can relax. I like that way of putting it, the way you have it. So he holds the egos of the shuttle
to give from it this nature into each. So you give from it.
Mm-hmm.
You give from it.
So is it, it appears
this
like...
this nature. Right, so you're incorporating the universal in the particular.
Mm-hmm.
By grasping the idea, you take a particular form of it. So then the particular still retains the general, doesn't it? Right?
Well, we don't name the particular correctly.
Yeah. So if he has named your... he's named Uranus, Cronus, and Zeus correctly. See, that's when he's functioning as a dialectician.
Mm-hmm.
That's really a very high point of the dialogue.
Yeah.
You say it doesn't matter how you spell it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That's the proper metaphysics, that's the proper names for those three gods.
Mm-hmm.
Why, what does that mean then? Then Zeus still retains the other two.
Uh-huh.
Right? And working backwards, or working forward.
That would follow the idea of the offspring that we talked about earlier, too.
Mm-hmm.
That is that if he was a pious offspring, I was thinking that in terms of the description of being an offspring of Aristus and Agamemnon, or I can't remember who else.
How about with Homer? I mean, with Hector.
Okay, Hector. It seems like the son, if he is the, I guess, proper offspring, or of the parent, then he's given a... a name that seems to be similar to the father. Oh, I was thinking of ruler.
No, it's not similar to the father because it's a king.
Oh, the offspring of each class would be of the same class.
Okay. But Hector's son doesn't get his name because his father is a king.
No. That's right.
Rather?
Yeah. I don't remember that quote, but that's... he apparently did something, I don't remember.
Walk the wall.
37.
Page 37.
Walk the walls. Guard.
He alone defended their city.
Okay. If he functioned that way.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I don't know how you guys feel about this. Page 39, where he makes that description of Hector. He said, hey, you know what? Both of those names agree. They mean nearly the same thing, indicating that their names are the king. But surely a man is holder. And a king, you say that anyone who holds is a king? What have you held today?
Possession.
Right, that make you a king? That'd be nice to know. That's how you function. surely a man is holder of that which is, he is Lord. So if you're holding, whatever you hold at that time, whatever you're holding at that time, you're Lord of that thing. But if you're holding something today, right, now, this day, then you should hold it as a king. Wait a minute, what kind of a king? The Eidos king, the ideal king. Therefore you have to be just, right?
Make
all of
laws.
Those things follow. All right, pardon?
Make laws.
Then into the degree to which you hold it, you can say that you rule it. You are held, you are being ruled. Therefore, what do you want? You want the holder and the beheld on the highest level, don't you? On the ideal.
Functioning through some intermediary called for.
Yeah. Like all of this is only true on the highest level. Because on a superficial level, it's not true at all. And the things that you hold, it doesn't make you a king. It's stupid. Right, isn't it? It's stupid.
Yeah.
On one level, depending upon you hold the way you hold things. May you not hold them with disdain? Well, there's a way of being in respect to that. Right? And don't hold it if you don't want to hold it. But if you're going to hold it like a king. So my idea of holding is like being a king. It's another name for king. Yeah, well, only on the ideal level. Then you have to be ideal to be a holder. Right? I mean, everything gets pushed up, doesn't it? Yeah, it's really quite an interesting process.
So, if you see it in being passed on by function,
is it passed on by function?
Or through function?
Is it passed on through function? Wait a minute.
Well, it strikes me that in that idea of Hector that the good sensing is as a result of how his father functioned.
Hmm?
You're saying it's passed on to his son because of the way his father functions. Right, does that go along with page 37? Does he have the name because it's passed on through his father? Therefore he inherits it?
No.
But that's what you're saying, isn't it? That's
well,
not the function
it.
Of the king. Passed on the function of the king, is that what you said?
Well, I'm trying to see how you feel it would be passed on from one offspring to another. Much like you described.
Sure.
The God.
How the is passed on through generation? Through what? What just passed on?
To the offspring.
Passed on to the offspring. And you have one more part? As?
As was seen in the reign of Simon Caesar.
Right. Yeah, okay, what do you work on that? I was trying to say how the Yusida was passed on to the offspring as it was in this case.
your question already assumes, let's hope it's true, that you do understand how the usia was passed on through this. And now you just want to see how it is on another level. It is clear to you, according to this question, that you don't have a question of how the usia is passed on from 1 to 3. Is that right? Now that you have this, I was trying to see how the usia was passed on the offspring. Is that right?
Yes, yeah.
Are we together?
Yeah.
Then this part must already be settled, and now you want to see how it's being passed on another level from offspring to offspring.
Well, I have a question.
At this point, the thing to do is to make a deal.
Right.
Right? I'll answer her question if she explains this part.
Yeah, that's right.
Right, wouldn't you?
And she has the easy
part. And she has the easy part, since that was already assumed, you know.
Sure.
Okay, you're having a little fun, but your question, the question you're posing, has this built into it. So, so long as you're clear about this, why can't you answer this?
Yeah, because that's the higher question.
See, if you are clear about this, which is the more profound, why can't you answer this, which is the mundane? Right? I mean, of course, you might say sometimes the mundane is more complex to understand than I do. Therefore, the hell with that kind of reason. You know, don't give us that bullshit.
There's so many mundanes.
Right. Right. But in any case, the background is Hector and his son, is what you've been looking at, hasn't it? Pardon?
That's what I brought up.
Yeah, that's what I brought up. So, this is the model. And you want to see how it happens here.
Well, I think what I recall is that when you described earlier the fact that Zeus seemed to be exactly how you put it, it struck me that it was similar to the way he described the relationship between how he talked about Hector and his son.
Okay, which is? Which is?
That the way the son got his name was with respect to how his father had functioned.
Son got his name the way his father functions. Right? Then you have an answer to your question. Right? You have an answer to your question. Right? That's an answer, isn't it? Right, this is an answer.
Right. But I don't... I would say, yeah, that's what I was originally seeing.
Then the son got his name from the way his father functioned. So each of these, right, got their name in the way in which their parent, right? Function.
Mm-hmm. That's how I understood what was being said earlier.
Then whatever name Zeus has, like the etymology of it, the two parts of it, he got his name in the way in which Kronos functions. Right? Kronos got his name in the way in which Uranus functions. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
I understood it,
yes. Yeah. Okay. Well, then you have the answer to your question, don't you?
Well, that isn't the answer. I mean,
No. See, this appears to be a question. I was trying to see how, but this is an answer, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, then, you've already figured it out. Why the question? I was trying to figure out how. Right.
How the Usia?
Yeah.
Was passed on.
I mean, well, you do have an answer, don't you? I mean, how do you have?
Yeah, I'm asking how the Usia is passed on. I'm not sure the relationship between Usia and function.
Well, if you're not sure about the Hosea and the idea of function differ, then how can you have that question? Doesn't this question presuppose that you know? You know about Hosea, just wondering about how it's passed on. Is that right? Or did our reflection cause you to go back to this and say, hey, by the way, I'm not sure of this?
Well, I think the way I put how I was trying to see how the Usia was passed on to the offspring was a statement I made, that's true, but in reflecting upon it, it seems like I didn't see a question. I had this as an insight with respect to the offspring, so I went back there to state what I did see. With what I had thought you had said with respect to Zeus, Cronus, and Uranus. So I would say that in putting it in a question form like that confused the insight that I had thought back here. And then what it did is resulting in terms of the reflection, I saw this question about Usia and function.
I wonder whether or not your question is, would you mind explaining again what you saw about these three names?
Okay. No, I don't think I had
okay,
that
look
question at the time.
Try this one now. Will you go to page 37?
Okay.
Right. You go to page 37?
I've certainly lost it. That's
yeah,
true.
Will you go back to 37? Right. Did the son get his name from the way his father functioned?
I don't know.
Well, just read it.
Wow.
Yeah.
There,
how
there, as it seems, it is right to call the son of the defender, lord of the city, ruler of that which his father is owner, said as defender.
Let us then consider, go ahead, on 37, go ahead.
The reason for this.
Yeah.
Does he not himself indicate the reason most admirably? He alone defended their city and long walls.
What did he do?
He defended their city.
Yeah, keep reading that, therefore?
Therefore, as it seems, it is right to call the son of the defender, lord of the city, ruler of that which his father, as Homer says, defended.
So then, what was he doing?
What was he
doing? Did he get his name from the way his father functioned or the way he functioned?
I don't know.
Well, how did the kid function? Right. What's the boy's right name? You have a choice. How is it settled?
So he's lord of the city.
And what is he doing?
Ruler of that which his father defended.
Yeah, well, no, just, he alone defended their city and long walls. Mm-hmm. Who's that?
Who's who?
Well, I don't know who's who. We're together trying to puzzle out something, mm-hmm. All right? And if it wasn't a puzzle, we'd be wasting our time. Okay? Now, who's the he in there? Then he thought Astyanax was more rightly the boy's name than Scadmandrius. Why? Well, consider the reason for this. Now, who's the he? In the quote, who's the he?
I assumed it was his father.
Oh, okay, look here. That's easy. Look here. If the he in that quote is Hector.
He defended his home.
Pardon?
Who's he?
Then it's easy, isn't it? If it's the son, would you go in another way? Come on, Janet.
Yeah, the he in the quote. Yeah.
Yeah, the he in the quote.
Yeah.
The he above it isn't his home.
Right.
Hey, come on, please stay with us. Come on. Do you see, is that possible that it could be both or not? Or not? You say, no, it could only be one.
See as the son, I see as Hector, because of what follows. Because the son then, I guess, becomes the ruler rather than the defender.
Okay, if the son becomes the ruler,
or
is the ruler?
Is the ruler.
Is the ruler. In fact, then what is Hector?
Defender.
Hmm? Then Hector is the defender?
Or he was, yes.
Or he was. What's happening now? Come on, stay with it.
Well, it looks like it doesn't pass on function. Or he doesn't get his name in terms of how a father functioned.
Why?
Well, then he would be a defender himself.
Oh, well, therefore you're going to he is what now?
But what?
Well, yeah, so your mom, I don't want you to talk to yourself. I want you to talk to me and talk. Okay? What are you just saying now?
Well, he didn't pass on directly the function of his father, that is the defender function.
How can you pass on a function directly?
I don't know.
But that's what you just said. Function is what? An activity, something that you do. Right, an activity.
Mm-hmm.
Can you pass that on?
Well, I don't think you can pass it on.
Well, okay, go back here then, all right? Now you're saying this doesn't look like it fits because, come on.
Well, Hector was a defender, but as a ruler, his son would be a defender of the city on a higher level.
His son?
Ruler.
Would be a ruler on a higher level because of what reason?
Well, defender of the city, as a ruler of the city. He'd be a defender of the city on a higher level, that is, as a
defender,
ruler.
Okay, defender of the city on a higher level. Why?
It just seems like a ruler would attempt to govern and the city.
Who would?
The ruler.
And that's the son? Mm-hmm. Well then, I thought Hector was a ruler.
No, I didn't.
Wasn't he the king? The next pirate?
I don't know, was he?
for their names over what? In the next paragraph. Yes, are they both names for a king?
Yes.
Huh? Well, okay. Are there are two names, and they're both names of the king. Is that right? Two names for a king. Does the son get one? And the father gets one? What's the name the son gets? Does he get it? Does he get it because he is a son of a king, therefore a prince gets that name? It all depends on a curious word. Steve, how are you going to read that? Listen, that's right.
I'd have to go with Iliad to check it. That.
Well, but above it, is it not true that Homer says the child of Hector was called Astyanax? So
that's who we got as the subject.
That's who we got. Mm-hmm.
And he alone defended their city and long walls.
Yeah, and what do you say on that?
That must be the son.
If Bill is correct, if that's the son, what would follow? Okay, then Astyanax had a son. Now, what would his son be? Hector?
No, Lord of the city.
Oh, he had a son, and his son would be Lord of the city.
Mm-hmm.
Where does it talk about his son being Lord of the city? Read it out loud.
Well, if Antiochus alone defended their city and long walls, therefore, as it seems, it is right to call the son of the defender Astyanax ruler of that which his father, that is, I guess, is Hector, defended.
Well, what if you put a comma? Put a comma after defender.
It's a mistranslation.
Yeah, it stinks.
I speculate with the word ruler, but the Greek has a... word for savior.
Soteros.
Mm. Oh, that's not...
Yeah, let's get the...
That's, you know, Zeus.
That won't help.
What? You see, it seems the confusion here is, first of all, we're understanding that there's two people we're talking about, besides Homer. We're talking about Hector, and we're talking about his son. Now, his son has two names.
That's right.
One is called by one group of people, and one is called by another, and we're trying to see which of these names is accurate.
That's right.
Okay, now...
Wait. Did you go along with this reasoning?
It's open.
Huh?
Yeah.
Right. And one the men call and the other the women call.
Yeah, go ahead. All right. Okay, so then it says the son,
mm-hmm.
He alone defended their city and long walls.
No, it didn't.
It says, Socrates said, then he thought Astyanax was more rightly the boy's name than Scamandrius. So it appears. Let us then consider the reason for this. Does he not indicate the reason admirably, for he says, he alone defended their city and long walls?
Okay, he's talking about he alone, the defender guy,
yeah.
Defended the city.
Mm-hmm. And then whatever. Whoever this is. It's either Homer or his son.
Right. Right? No, it's either Hector.
I mean Hector or his son, right? It's gotta be one of the two.
Well, he alone is a defender.
And Taylor picks it up as he integrates the quote above. Says Astyanax the Trojan called the boy from his great father, the defense of Troy.
See, Astyanax is 2 years old.
That was Hector.
In the story.
Okay. Well, not at two, anyhow. No. Right.
So it can't be by his function.
Then the he can't be Astyanax.
That's right. It has to be his father.
Yeah.
Right? It depends entirely on who the he is.
Yeah.
And you can read it that way, too.
Which way?
The way we just said.
That is Hector.
He is Hector.
Okay.
It can be read that way.
Oh, I think you can read it. Yeah. Yeah, it can be read that way. Right. And if it is read that way, then he's getting his name from his father. And the way his father functioned. Then he doesn't deserve the name himself.
No, he doesn't know yet.
Huh?
Well, no, he wouldn't deserve the name if he was called
Lord.
Defender of the City.
No, he doesn't deserve it.
But he's not called the Defender of the City. He's called Little Lord of the City.
Or Lord well, he's called Lord of the City.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah, okay. But he's not the Lord.
Not yet.
Not yet.
So the ruler of
he's
which
being
his,
called that.
Yeah, his father. Ruler of which his father defended. But he's not ruling yet, is he?
Well, that shows why.
Did he rule
Troy
the city ultimately?
No, he got thrown off the wall.
Thrown off. Yeah.
Hmm.
But I think the bottom line is goes over to 39 when Sock says, because the name seems to me similar to Astyanax, and both names seem to be Greek, for Lord and Holder mean nearly the same thing, indicating their names of a king. For surely a man is holder of that which he is Lord. So he's saying that if the two guys are functioning the same and their names sound the same, then they're accurately named.
Did Hector defend the city in the same relationship as his son ruled? His son fell and so did the city. Just wondering.
He fell and so did his son.
But the thing is, I don't see how we got the Usia passed on here. Gina?
Well,
The way,
if it can be read this way, right? Because it depends entirely on that.
Yeah.
All right. If he is Hector, then he's the defender of the city.
Mm-hmm.
All right. And he gets the name purely by inheritance.
Mm-hmm. The son does.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Then Hector and his son are related in such a way he got his name and the way in which his father functioned. All right. Now, if that's true, then you see this, don't you? I mean, this is what you gave, all right? Then how can you have this question? How is the Osea then passed on? You'd say by what?
Nothing.
But he's not functioning. Look here. Let's take this as what's going on. What does the next paragraph do to the structure? What does he do in the next paragraph? The whole purpose of the next paragraph.
To say that they do have the same function.
Yeah. That the two names are holders.
The two names have the same function, and therefore indicate.
Yeah, well, the next paragraph.
Oh, the next paragraph?
Yeah.
Which would be, which one?
If I'm right.
Therefore, it seems,
oh, yeah, the horse.
The horse?
It is right, I think, to call a lion's offspring a lion and a horse offspring a horse.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. So if this guy turns out to be a coward, then
so if this guy turns out to be a coward,
we call him a coward.
We call him a coward and not a lord.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter what his father did.
Is that what the next? Is that what this paragraph is?
Mm-hmm. What's the name the women of Troy?
So the one above it is talking about the Eidos. That both of those names function.
He didn't say what scamandrous means, did he?
That's right. Right. So, the example with the animals, which is the one we're in now, but keep watch on me, and do not let me trick you, for by the same argument, any offspring of a king should be called a king. Mm-hmm. And whether the same meaning is expressed in one set of syllables or another makes no difference. As long as the essence of the thing remains in force, and is made plain in the name.
Yeah, but a coward wouldn't remain in force. If he was a coward, his essence would be that of a coward, not of a king.
Yeah, now go down to the bottom paragraph on that same page. Does not the same reason apply to a king? A king's son will probably be a king. A good man's good. A handsome man's handsome. And so forth. The offspring of each class will be of the same class. Unless some unnatural birth takes place.
Right.
Right, and the example he gives is the physician. Right, even though the physicians drugs they may be called by various names in various places, you must consider how they function, right? It's only their medical value is the same. It's only if their medical value is the same.
Right. Aspirin is aspirin.
Whether it's liquid, powder, tablet, whatever.
Cherry flavor or
that's
liquor.
Right.
Baked in a cake.
Son of a wolf becomes a wolf.
So it's only if that same unique quality is passed on.
A briar patch.
Right. It's only if that same unique quality is passed on.
Mm-hmm. Right. Right.
Handsome. Handsome has handsome children.
Mm-hmm.
Good man has a good child. Right. If that quality is passed on. Right. Is that what the paragraph is doing?
Yeah, that one.
Right. And how would you determine that? In some cases, by sight.
Those are contrary to nature.
Right.
Unnatural, something going on.
No, something unnatural came on that it wouldn't be passed on.
Something would happen. It might be destroyed or muted or changed. I see.
Mm-hmm. Come on, let's push it. Down the bottom of 43. And how about those who are born contrary to nature approaches? For instance, when an impious son is born of a good man and a pious man, what he not is the former example. When a mare brought forth a calf, to have the designation of the class which he belongs, instead of that of his parent. Right? Mm-hmm. Then if his son grows up and is not able to function in that way, he doesn't deserve the name. Mm-hmm.
And the usia didn't get passed on.
And the usia didn't get passed on.
But aren't most names given before a child grows up, functions in a certain way?
Yeah, but this guy's the name is Lord.
Ruler?
Hmm?
Ruler of the city?
Yeah, that's what he's saying. Isn't that his name? Ruler?
Yeah.
Lord of the city?
But is a child that?
Yeah, but he got the name. Now, if he doesn't live up to it, we'd say the usia was not passed on.
Mm-hmm. He's a prodigy.
Yeah,
he would, that would have been his name.
And therefore, it was he's
he was in the wrong place.
Right.
The person
who
gave him the name didn't know how to give the proper name.
Right.
Would that then mean that the namer would have to be a seer as well?
I don't know. What do you think?
Well, you need to be able to tell what the child is going to be like when he's older.
Or he's in the wrong class, that's right. And if he's in the wrong class, the man has to put him in the wrong class. But in one case, all rulers should have, should be in a direct line of kings. Right? Each of them should be kings. Okay. From the way we're reading, what's this now, Jim?
Well, as I said, that came out of when I originally heard you say something about Zeus and Cronus. I saw this down here when you asked me further what was my question. Was the only thing I could think of at the time, but it doesn't fit.
I don't know what that means. It's the only thing I could
what
think
I'm
of
saying
at the time.
Is that it's not a question that I wanted to ask. This is what I wanted to say.
What is the this? This?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, that's all right. You did this. This is the point you wanted to make.
Right.
Wasn't it more of a question that concerns seeing offspring in two places?
Mm-hmm.
And seeing how it's functioning, you know?
And
yeah, I thought that's what she initially said, that there was two offsprings in the Cronus.
Yeah, yeah.
Uranus, Zeus,
yeah,
and the Hector.
Yeah, yeah. That,
and there was some confusion.
Astyanax had a son. Yeah.
But
well,
obviously not.
I think my question is, we have an analogy here between the Cronus, Uranus, Cronus, and Zeus, and how usia is passed from offspring to offspring, from father to son. And we're comparing this to Hector and his son. So we have an analogy, we have the relationship of passing on of usia. What I didn't see is the assumption that we know how the usia got passed on. I think we can say, okay, after a kid grows up and we can see that he is like his father, if that is good, then we can say the usia got passed on. But how did that come about?
No, that's different. That's right. To ask how the usia was passed on to father and son in a line of kings is not answered by saying it's passed on.
No, that's after the fact. You can say, yeah.
I mean, but it's not. It simply says that's the case.
Yeah, it may not have been passed on.
It may have come out a certain kind of progeny,
mm-hmm.
and that's what they have, unless there's some prodigy, which is mm-hmm. outside of the normal lineage. Mm-hmm. He's saying there's a natural order.
Unless something unnatural gets in
mm-hmm.
the way.
Right. And if mm-hmm. something unnatural gets into that breeding, it should be that a good king should have a good son who's a king, who in turn becomes a king. And the only way he's saying that you can find that out is to see how they function. And if the function isn't the same as the name,
then you have to
assign them to a new class.
And then the question you have to ask is, what was the unnaturalness that came in that caused the
from passing on of the usia, not how it got passed
not how
on.
It got, because that's natural.
That's natural. You have to ask what interrupted it.
Yeah, that's right. That's what he does in the Republic. Right? The breakdown of the Republic. He asks, how did the fall occur?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Fourth book.
Yeah. It's already assumed that it's going to be passing on until finally there's going to be a mismarriage.
Yeah, and that's when the cobbler dresses up and marries the...
That could be. That could be. Yeah, so.
They have that interesting practice of, you know, the gold and the silver and the bronze and the children are in common, but the guardians know which are the children of the appropriate breeding, don't they?
Yeah.
And yet they still have to function at that level in order to be given the education of the guardian. They still, that's right, because don't they say they bring the silver, the gold in, mm-hmm. and if there are sons of golden that are not golden, then they give them the appropriate education. Mm-hmm. So that's the same model.
The same function.
Same idea.
When I read this originally, I read this as he was functioning. I read that he has the son.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So it was fun to go through it.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. He's 2 years
as a matter of fact, I will still, you know, now that I go back and I look at it, and I say that's a very confused sentence.
Mm-hmm.
Just structurally in English, that's a terrible sentence. You know, I don't know what...
Yeah.
The antecedent isn't clear, but it's much nicer this way that they both get the same name, because that fits in the development of what's going on, and it's only later that they make the check that the way to determine whether or not it's been passed on is to see how they function. Functioning correctly, and obviously, you know, that's a better development than to bring that point in earlier the way
yeah.
I was doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So I enjoyed that. That was good.
Well, what kind of a model is he using there for in the Uranus, Cronus, Zeus? I mean, what's the shuttle? Is that the model? Uranus is the shuttle, or is the shuttle something that's common in each of them? There, as they were in different fabrics.
Whatever this is, it's going to then have a function. Whatever this is, because of the way it functions, it too has a function. Whatever this is, equally has a function. Right? There is such a thing as pure mind. It's a function, by the way.
So when we say that's the idea of the shuttle, then?
Well, no, I
it's a function. Mind can function, can it?
Mm-hmm.
That's different than what it is.
Yeah.
Then that becomes the next generation. Say, the way the mind functions, it functions.
The function of the mind
functions. Functions.
Okay.
All right, now go back and take a look at this.
So the shuttle is none of them, but that which runs through all of them.
Yeah. Well, I don't know about the... the image of the shuttle in this.
Well, that was the model we worked with last week for this. Right?
Yeah. With this?
Yeah. We read the section on nature, and then we applied it to this.
Okay. I thought we were talking about that. Okay. Now you go back and see whether that's the case. All right. Let's open up the book quick. Go back and see whether that's the case.
All right. Did you talk about Uranus?
Page 47. Doesn't start there.
49.
Oh, yeah.
47.
sentence starting, and his father also, he said to the Jews, appears to have a very excellent name. Not easy to understand.
So what you're saying then, Pierre, is that Zeus should be a functional description of Cronos.
And Cronos?
A functional description of Uranus.
Right.
Well,
essence, function, essence, function. Model, copy, model.
Cronus is the purity and unblemished function of mind. That's the great Dionoia, the great intellect.
I guess the problem is, like, what is the one of the three, right? Is it the upward gaze, then?
Well, that's what people call it, the upward gaze.
Yeah, well.
And it produces, that's pure mind.
But should that, if that's the one if that's the Aedas, right, then that should be reflected in Zeus.
It will. It will, but it has to go through Cronos first. Pure mind has a function. That's the great intellect. The great intellect has a function. That is the ruler and the sustainer of all life. Each is a way of its functioning of its predecessor.
Are any of those earlier models that he established therefore applicable here? Like the Bohr or the shuttle?
There's a specific natural process going on. The whole thing is based upon the idea that it's a natural process. The natural process is its function. So, the lesser becomes, in each case, the lesser is always an instrument. It does something. It does something. It has to do something. And what you're suggesting is this idea or eidos ousia, right? And thesis or function
Is that what you're doing?
No, I really wasn't.
Yeah, that was a question, wasn't it?
It was a question. What model, therefore, of the models you've played with underlies this etymology here? Is it the shuttle idea, and therefore there's a nados that's common in all three, and it's distinct from the three, or it's one of the three? Son functions like the father, and therefore he has the correct name. He's in the same ados, if the father's correctly named to begin with. So therefore Zeus, Cronus, and Uranus would all have something common in them, like Lord.
Or in this case, gods.
Gods, yeah, but you haven't really unpacked the nature of God.
Yeah, but I mean, that would be the...
The one of the many.
The one of the many. But I don't think that's the case. What we were doing last time was saying that this idea, there's an idea of a shuttle.
Right.
When a craftsman makes something, and in this case makes a particular shuttle, that has to have the particular, it has to have both the parent and the child, as I call it.
Yeah, the idea and the distinct features of the child. Right?
Yeah, or it has to have, it has to be adapted for a particular purpose.
Right.
And yet, within itself, still has to contain the general idea.
Right. Yeah.
So, each one of these, the point I was making last night was that each one of these contains within itself always its predecessor.
Well, what's the eidos then? See, because they're running, like on the level of shuttles, you're running horizontal,
yeah.
Horizontal, vertical. Well, here you're running vertical, right?
Yeah.
Just to use the spatial imagery for a moment. Like, they're members of a class, and these would be, as it were, three generations of itself.
Yeah. What I'm saying here is that, if you want to see how this functions, I think what needs to be seen is that in each pair, that process, this process goes on.
So it's a relationship between, it's a relationship therefore.
It's relationships, and then it's also this.
You mean the relationship of the relationships?
Yeah. Well, you see if this is the way you put relation to relationships. These two, Uranus and Cronus, for pure mind and Dionoia, or understanding. Pure mind, when it in its functioning, as soon as it functions, it's understanding. It's Dionoia. But in understanding, there has to be elements of pure mind.
But it has something that isn't pure mind.
Yes.
It's distinctiveness,
function.
Right?
Yeah.
A particular kind of fabric, then?
Yeah.
Right.
And in the same way, you can talk about this high functioning of understanding. When it functions as a ruler. A supreme ruler and giver of life.
Mm-hmm. Course of action comes out of the understanding.
Right? That's these two.
Mm-hmm.
But by the way, there's always the shadow of its predecessor. It's continued.
Mm-hmm.
Through the whole, that's this larger.
Well, yeah, but it's not in the differences, right?
Pardon?
It's not in the differences.
It's not.
The shadow, as it were, of the form is not in the differences, right? The,
no.
Right?
No.
It's in something which is
same.
Is the same in all.
Yeah, that's right. Or we could do it with colors. Now, it's kind of overlapping. Have that kind of thought. That fails to continue the color of blue. That's what I wanted to achieve.
Well, it'd be like the lessening power of a magnet or something. Or no.
Yeah, okay, let's try that.
The rings.
Yeah.
Yeah, these two contain this relationship. Mm-hmm. This one, though, is so different. Like, there's too much similarity between the two to continue the image. Oh.
Too much difference, yeah.
Well, there's a
difference
between these three.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And there isn't such a tight similarity between these two to be represented by two links in a chain. That's a,
Could you make one of the arrows blue and blue through it all, and then the other different?
But that wouldn't make any difference between what the thing is and the function. So that's why I'm trying to come.
So you said that you wanted to see it to be blue throughout it.
Yeah, that's true. But did you hear what I just said?
Yeah,
well, why didn't you ask? Maybe if we did this, that would show that there's some constant quality going throughout.
Why would you want to put the white around it?
Because something's different.
Because the difference is its function, isn't it? It's not where we're proceeding.
Oh, I thought the pink itself showed the blue.
Well, okay. The goal is, all right, I think the best one I have is this one, which is the old one. There is an object, it's picked up in a mirror, and in turn, is mirrored in another.
But some...
I didn't like that.
Tinted mirror. Form isn't retained.
Yeah.
Right. After a number of generations.
Yeah. The form is retained.
No, it wouldn't be, would it?
In this, you know,
it's like it's going to reach a point of indistinct.
Oh, no, it's going, this is watered down from each one.
Yeah.
And our, not necessarily here, no. But in the way we're proceeding.
Right. Somehow you'd have to make it cloudy from one to the other or something in the mirrors.
Maybe it's like some mathematical progression, you know, where
it's mathematical
fundamental ratio.
It's diffused as it proceeds.
That's right, yeah.
Expands up from that, but that ratio is contained in every pair. You know, like a double
that's
ratio.
That's true, double ratio. Like a harmonic. About the sense?
No, I was just thinking of it generally, you know, 2, 4, 8, 16, and so on out. There's a primary set of terms, right? They're irreducible.
Yeah.
And that's contained in all the succeeding generations.
But it becomes more multiple.
Yeah.
And therefore, in that sense, maybe diffused.
It seems awfully pure that way. Like you're not getting enough.
How about the sun? The sun to the moon.
Right.
To the night light.
To the night light, yeah.
Yeah, that's an awfully good one.
That's a great one.
That would have some.
To the moon reflected.
That's right.
In a lake.
That one always, yeah, right. And then the reflected out of the lake, yeah.
Yeah, that would be a way.
Okay, that's enough. What time is it?